For safety wise, you always want to wear safety glasses and always want to wear gloves. For this demonstration purposes, I'm not wearing gloves just simply so you can see. I'm a little concerned about it. I'm going to be truthful. I hate grinding without a glove. When I hit 36 and 60 grit, I will not in my shop approach that belt without a glove on. That ain't nothing but pea gravel and a motorcycle wreck waiting to happen right here. It will give you terrible road rash. That's why guys get their fingers ground off all the time. Most of the guys wear leather aprons because it keeps those sparks off of you. And as well as all the other above, it's really critical for earplugs. You will grind better with earplugs than without earplugs. And the reason why is because you may not really realize it, but the pitch of this running, the noise of it, will make you more tense. And you don't really realize it for a little while after you're grinding. And so if you're tense, you are not going to be as smooth operating with this. So you've got to wear some type of earplugs. If you do not have a ventilation system in your shop, wear a mask. I don't have a ventilation shop in my shop. My mask right now I'm wearing is 3 days old and it's gray already. So it's really critical. This stuff will not get out of your lung. In the old days, grinders very seldom lived to be 35 years old. They died of grinder's lung. They could use their lungs for canteens. They were so built up in there. So when they did the old style belly down grinding. So be sure, mask up, wear gloves, wear an apron, glasses, and earplugs. I don't have any of that because I need to show. If I have all that, I'm going to cover this up and you're not going to be able to see. All right, now when you're grinding, before we ever turn this thing on, I can tell you a lot about grinding. One is, I start with a round wheel instead of flat flat. And the reason is, when this blade is belt is dull on this flat flatten, it will still cut on a round wheel because when you put it on that round wheel, especially a 4-inch, it cracks this bonded. This is an X-weight belt, meaning the glue on it is really stiff. They have a flex belt, which is yellow belts up here, they're a flex. They're meant to, when you track it over the side, it will make a corner. This will not. This just keeps, it's an X, so it does not make corners. So my roughing, I always use an X grip belt, X weight belt. And then any other grinding is just cleaning up what I actually ground with 36 or 60. Since this scale on this, Mike and JR have to verify, but I think the scale is like 62, 68 Rockwell. So you're going to blow off a $7 belt just using just a belt to clean this with. So you're much better off go down there and get you one of them little 4-inch grinders for $1.25, knock the scale off with that little 4-inch disc grinder because it's a lot cheaper. You can do a dozen or two dozen blades knocking the scale off. Then that way when you come over here, it's a lot faster grinding. I hate all grinders. I hate my KMG less than the rest of them. But the most important thing is the what type of belt you're using and the tracking of this belt. Whether that will help you do your shoulder. Now, like I say, we're going to blow off this one good belt right here. And do not, some of the guys wants to keep on grinding even after that blade, this belt is dull. Don't do that. Yeah, the old saying, it takes money to make money, really applies to grinding. You're trying to milk the last 50 cents worth out of that belt. It's going to take you much longer, and it's not going to make very distinct, sharp lines, and it's going to cost you. It's going to slip. It's going to cost you. Just throw it away when it's half through. Sell it to the county. I sell mine to the county for 15 cents a belt. My throwaways, it's either that or burn them. And I wait till I get a barrel and I'll sell them or burn them. I just can't abide a dull belt because it's important when I'm grinding to get it done as efficiently but as quickly as possible. John's going to have to hold my buggy because we're going to be pushing this thing around if we don't. Now what I'll do, normally I use a 4-inch round wheel to do all this first work. What I'll normally do, I'll profile on a 4-inch round wheel all the way around, and then I'll come back in here and I'll, in a way, flat sand with my 4-inch wheel. One thing you want to do is you keep his arms locked in. It's just like forging. When you're forging, you don't take that shoulder off that side, like so. Because if you do, you've lost your effectiveness and you're going to get hammer tracks all in that blade when you get this arm away from here and forge it. Same way with grinding. If you get these elbows up here like this, you've lost your anchor point. That's where you get two-inch-itis. You come in here and you look, you've got a groove 2 inches wide because you've moved it this way because you have no support. So keep these hands locked in. You can grind a sword blade like this. You just may have to get a further out and get, I can grind that far right there. And then if I have to on a longer blade, I'll choke back up on it and I'll go ahead and I can grind a 30 inch blade that way. So first thing to do, get these arms anchored in. And the second is you gotta watch your feet placement. That's real critical. Because if you're leading off with the wrong foot, it's going to be hard to. When I'm grinding on this side, I have my left foot out. When I'm grinding on this side, or left in, excuse me, not out, but in. When I'm over here, my right foot's in. Because that gives me my balance. And if you'll notice, I'm not moving my hands. I'm moving my legs, my whole body. It's all coming off my feet. And this way I can keep this thing steady. Because if you get off like this, you're going to end up running over the back. You're going to end up with 2-inch-itis. All kind of ills is going to be set upon you when you start getting off here waving them arms like a goose. Now, yeah, you can try it with that foot like that, but as you can see, I'm already off balance and can't make it because I let off the wrong foot. So you got to get that right foot in there. Now everybody when they grind, especially beginning, if you've only been grinding and making knives for a year or two, I can look at your knife and tell you if you're left-handed or right-handed. The reason is everybody has a strong side and a weak side. And most of the time, the guys will grind with their strong side first, and only you're going to know which one's your strong side. But they're grinding their strong side first because he knows it, you know you can do it, okay? So now, you're over here on your weak side, and you're trying to make that match up, that's going to be really difficult. So always grind your weak side first, because your strong side, you have better control. This is my strong side, so I can make this match up with the other side a lot easier. So always kind of learn which is your side that it's the hardest for you to grind in. Grind that, and that way that other side will catch up real quick.
All right, first thing I'm
going to
do is profile.
You will notice I'm pushing in like this and I'm not really moving my hands. This is called an organic tool rest. It's going to be critical. Even when I was younger and had a flat belly, I would extend my stomach out on purpose because it's really critical. The height of your grinder is critical. You want right between your belly button and your belt is where you want the center of this round wheel. If it is too high, you're not going to get the pressure and you're going to lose control. If it's too low, the parts are going to burn. So you want it about this height, and you just move back and forth. Come off the round wheel with your profile and with what we do here, and this is all we're going to get done tonight. We want to get that finished. You'll want to be able, when you go to your platen, you don't want to make over 3 passes and you're just dead flat. So you want to get really close with the 4-inch round wheel. When we go doing the side, and I'll show you in a little bit, just bear with me. One thing, I don't know if you noticed, when I was doing this, I wasn't doing my hands like this. I do my entire body. Okay, like this, the same way it's here. You notice I was doing this because I have control this way. I don't here. All right, so now we profile with our flat here and here. The only other profile we're going to do is the flat before we move to the round. Again, you gotta keep his arms locked in.
That's scary to do without gloves.
What we're gonna do right now is see where we touched off on our Ricasso. You can see the quality of forging that you do when you're in here. Like here, we touched off here, the back, and here. That's it. And this is, we're gonna do this both sides till we're almost flat. That gives me a rough idea of, am I off center? Is my forging off center? Is it not? Everything on that knife is going to start and stop right here. So first thing we do, since this is going to be the center of everything, we take care of it first. And this thing is pushed up right now, and the grinder's on, the grinder's running, and we've got our Ricasso. We're holding here and we're pushing here. Okay, look with your eyes. One of the more critical things is learning how to read the sparks on a grinder. So what you do, you look down in there, in between where the blade is and the grinder is. You can see when we push it this far forward, maybe 5 more degrees is all we have. You're not going to be able to see then. And I know then when I'm in full contact with the blade up in here, in there, then I know I've got a straight line. One of the more common things that you're going to run into, especially beginning, and even now, 30 years later, I still have to watch this on every stinking knife. This is going to bite you. A very common thing is for this Ricasso to be thinner here than it is here. And one of the, oddly enough, the only way I can get away with that, if I push straight in like this, I'm going to get that thinner every time. And so what I have to do, and I'm going to exaggerate this, what I'd have to do is apply pressure this way. So instead of flat in like that, I'm actually got pressure this way. And the reason is this blade is wider here. This is where you're holding. You're holding out here. You're not holding in line with the Ricasso. You're holding here. So it makes you want to, natural human says that you're going to apply more pressure there, and that thins that down. So I twist mine, if you would, put a little bit more pressure this way. And it's okay if I end up a little thinner here, or this ends up a little thicker, but my grind line's here, that's okay. I can make this catch up real easy because it wants to thin out anyway naturally. So I always apply a little bit more pressure toward the spine side, and that keeps that little thin. For a guy out in the field hunting, it's not going to make any difference. If you're going to try to go to the knife shows where there's knowledgeable collectors, this is the area that he's going to look at, right here. One of the things they're going, first thing they're going to look at is they're going to look and see if that same thickness this is. It's the grind line in the center. That's one of the first things they look at. And then they start looking at the fit of the guard and blah, blah, blah. So you got to watch this. So we still have to flatten out. But if you'll notice that on the grind here, we were grinding in even. We weren't just grinding all for one side, and it's because I'm tweaking it over a little bit. And then, see there where I put a little bit more pressure here, and we didn't quite touch off here. When you're grinding, what I say about reading the sparks, right where this junction line is between the spine and the here, you'll see when you're in full contact, there'll be a real tiny little row of sparks right there. And that means you're in full contact. Stop. Right there. It's reading where these sparks are is going to be really critical. That lets you know when you run over the back of it, when, you know, are you not there yet, that kind of thing.